So, Wi-Fi is working? Okay, well, this is actually a short joke. This is what we want to avoid people see in their in the application, in the website. So, I'm Jurik Vergalen. I work for Computest since 2005, and I'm a performance test specialist. So I'm the guy who annoys you with bugging with your bad infrastructure. I'm involved with many projects. I've done many projects on big cloud environments, CDN infrastructures, and I like to break stuff, so I like to break the websites that you host and that you create. This is a small picture of the company I work for. This is Computest. This is our playground, and this is the place where we hide and where we go back, and yeah, we have a work hard, play hard mentality. The goal of this talk, I want to share some experience that I have with testing some big cloud environments, big cloud applications like TV sport events, TV shows like The Voice. So I will cover that and what we've seen there and what common performance issues we've seen. And among the experience that that I've built up on all those performance tests on of applications, I share the common performance issues that that we see. And talk about how to test these platforms. Types of performance tests. People here who is involved with performance tests for their applications or their infrastructures. So probably less than 10% has some kind of experience with performance testing in their application. So just get back with some quick basics about performance testing. There are several types of performance tests, and the usual types that we do is the load test, probably well known. And the load test is a test to test the response times and the behavior on a certain amount of load. Then you have an endurance test, and the goal of the endurance test is to test the stability of the application. And what we do with an endurance test is we simulate load on the application for as long as possible and see does the application still work? Doesn't response times increase over time? What's the trend? And do we see some trends with some failing functionalities like garbage collections and so on that could impact response times? And last but not least, the stress test. And the stress test is the test that we do most. And I think the stress test is the test that I find most interesting, because with the stress test, we put load on the system, we increase the load until the system crashes. It's also the test where we get the most information out of the behavior of the application, because we get to know the maximum capacity of the application, so how many users can the application handle, how many page views can it handle, or how many transactions it can do within a minute. But while we do that, while we increase the load and find the maximum capacity, we also want to know why. Why is that the maximum capacity of the application or the environment? So we want to know what is the bottleneck and can we tune that? So another schematic overview of how a typical stress test looks like. What we do is we increase users constantly over time. And with that, when we simulate users, the number of requests obviously increases. But there is a moment in time, when the load gets too high. It cannot handle any more requests per second than it does. So at that moment, requests per second just stagnates, and response times increases, or lots of errors starts to occur. And that's the moment where we hit the bottleneck, and we want to explore what is it and why is it, and can we tune that. So another key aspect, I think, of performance tests is that you have to do realistic simulation. And with all performance tests that we do, we want to mimic the behavior of the users as good as possible. So that means that we want to mimic and hit the proper pages and the proper functionalities on the application. And also with the right balance. So for example, if you have a web shop, most users will just navigate around, browse, click, view products, but they won't end up buying stuff, or not everyone will hit the search button. So to do a good performance test, we also want to mimic the good behavior. So in the end, the application and the infrastructure won't see any difference between the robot users or real users. Another important thing to do a good simulation is to mimic also their pace, how fast they click through the page and through the application. Because if you test like a robot and you click the application as fast as possible, you will not be realistic. And the reason to be realistic is that only if you test realistic, you will hit the proper bottleneck. So if you hit the homepage like crazy and you do only that, it's likely that you will hit another bottleneck than if you do all the functionalities in the good pace. So important thing. And it's also important to use good test data. So every user that we simulate, we want that to have a unique account. So we don't want to reuse the same account all over and over again. To prevent caching, for example. So how does a test infrastructure look like? So not the application, but test setup. Just quickly, as a tester, you work on the controller. The controller orchestrates the test. It connects to lots of load generators. And on the load generators, that's where the actual simulation happens, where all the virtual users are simulated. And in some cases, it's good to have a geographically spread user base or geographically spread load generators to simulate the load realistic. And those load generators will hit the application. Hit the application on the front end. So we get the information of response times, errors, etc. that users would see. And on the other side, we want the controller to monitor all the backend applications, the backend servers. For monitoring CPU usage, network throughput, etc. So we get a complete view of the performance, what the response time is in the front, how many page views users actually will do, and what the CPU usage is with that load. And with tests, with these performance tests, we can see the response times of every user, and we see all errors. So then, if you have a cloud environment or you use the CDN to handle your statics, you could consider, why should I care about performance tests? Because my cloud environment will scale anyway. I just put on more machines, more instances, and it will handle it anyway. Or, CDN is proven technology. It will handle my statics. So what can I do? Why should I care about tests? Well, some experience proves otherwise, and especially for event-based applications. If you have an event, like you have a TV show, or there is a sports event, there are practically zero users 1 minute, and a few minutes later, there are thousands of users, hundreds of thousands, or even millions of users at the application. And with those events, by doing performance tests, we found several issues that seem to be really common. So I want to talk about a record test of 2 million concurrent users that that I've did. It was for the TV show The Voice. You probably know that. And well, in the Netherlands, they won't have 2 million concurrent users, but it's a much bigger environment. They also host it in the UK, US, etc. So their platform needed to be able to handle 2 million votes, actually. So they expect 2 million users to vote within 7 seconds, and that was also the requirement. So, and they had no chance to just wait for it in production and see how it goes, and when it fails, then just, yeah, change it, and okay, next show it will be better. There was no chance. It had to be right at the start. So that's why performance testing is really necessary. So we want to simulate it. We just want to simulate a load, simulate the show. But yeah, 2 million users is incredible amount of users to simulate. So not only talking about the application that needs to be needed to handle lots of votes per second, but from a testing perspective, it was also a challenge. So what did we do and what did we have? We used 800 load generators to simulate all the users. And a single load generator was able to handle at least 2,500 virtual users at the same time. And we used different cloud providers for that to have a geographically spread base and also test over different transits. Another important feature was that we used lots of different DNS servers. So we installed local DNS servers on the load generators. I will come back to that later, why that was important. And we used Neotis Neoload as the tool. That's our preferred tool for a large-scale performance tests. So first test on the for the voice application, it ended horrible, actually. The blue line that you see here is the number of users. So we just started increasing users and simulating users that open the app, log in to the application, and only waiting for the event to start so they can vote. So this wasn't even it was even without votes. And what you see is in red, that's the number of errors. And the brown line underneath is the response times of those requests. Well, what we've seen here is that you see some occasional spikes of errors. So suddenly there are lots of errors, and then it's fine, and then boom, there are lots of errors. The reason for that was auto-scaling. They tried auto-scaling for their application. So once the load gets higher, they spin up more machines. Well, we already thought that was not a good idea. But in many tests, we've seen that auto-scaling does not work well for event-based applications. If you have just a sudden spike of users, auto-scaling will just be too late. Usually, you have all kinds of settings how you want to auto-scale, but usually it looks to the CPU usage of an average of 5 minutes, and when it's higher than 60 or 70%, it decides to start to spin up more instances. But then it takes already 5 minutes for it to realize that it has to spin more machines, and then when it has to start, and then it takes time too to get into the pool. And what we also see is when they start getting into the pool, into the load balancer, the services are not just properly started yet. So lots of users receive errors when they hit that specific instance. So lots of things can be done to improve the auto-scaling logic. Some other common issue that we found on those cloud infrastructures is that scaling won't help in all cases. You need to know the limit of a single instance. If you don't know the limit of a single instance, it could be the case that scaling won't help. If you have common issues or file descriptors, maximum file descriptors, or maximum connections towards the to the instance. And you can scale whatever you want, but it will not help you with more load. So also know the limits. Another thing is, once we start testing, they decided for an instance type, CPU memory balance, and well, they just stick to that because that's what's once decided, and they will have it for forever. But yeah, with testing, you can see what's the proper balance before you go live, and could save some money. Pre-warming, or in this case, specifically pre-warming of the Elastic Load Balancer. Anyone familiar with pre-warming an Elastic Load Balancer? I see a few, just a few hands. Every time we test, or every first test on the day that we do, we hit errors on the load balancer of Amazon, for example. And that's because the infrastructure doesn't have any load yet, so it was bound to a low, small-scaled elastic load balancer. And then when we increase the load, the load balancer cannot handle it, and it takes up to 15, 20 minutes for it to realize that it needs to scale to a more bigger elastic load balancer. So that's something that you cannot have in an event because you have no organic increase of load. So there's a service of Amazon that you can request pre-warming, so it will set you to a more proper load balancer before the event starts. So in the end, after lots of tests, tuning, setting up, they decided not to go for auto-scaling, but just start hundreds of instances already. We had a proper test. We had a good test with very good results. The blue line goes up to 2 million concurrent users. And the green line shows the number of requests per second. So when we had 2 million users, we started contestant to go, and the app will automatically vote. We ended up with 8,000 requests per second without any pain, no errors. So, success. So that was all cloud-based instances infrastructures. Another test that I've done is Champions League streaming. And the goal of that test was to test with 50,000 concurrent viewers. And that comes along with lots of bandwidth. How did their environment look like? They had an origin, obviously, their own application environment, to serve the files, to serve files to the CDN. They used multiple CDNs for either fallback and just to spread more, to have a better spread of files. They used HLS as the streaming protocol. The streaming protocol serves small segments of files to the user, and it those segments have just a portion of the stream, and it can handle lots of different bit rates. So every different bit rate is a different file name, and that is a key feature, key thing in the test. We also wanted to do a realistic user simulation, so we wanted to test all the bit rates in the same, in a proper balance, of that users would probably look at the stream, because it's very important to test all the streams at the same time, and not just go for a single stream, because I'll come to that back later. Also, we are only bound to tests from the Netherlands because they had a geo IP lock on the environment because of TV rights. So also in the test setup, we were only able to test from the Netherlands. So we used all kinds of different cloud providers so we can hire lots of instances to simulate load up to 100 gigabit. And also we use our own environment. Any of you familiar with how CDNs work and how they serve files, objects to users, browsers? Yeah, a lot more. When a user or the player wants to retrieve a file, it tries to resolve the host name of the origin, and then it responds back to, okay, you have to go to the CDN for that specific IP address. Then the CDN knows where your DNS server is and tries to and gives back the IP address of the best possible edge server for you, which is the most likely best possible edge server for you. It could mean with the lowest latency, or even the most proper edge server, which is capable of serving you. And then the user connects to the edge server, requests the file. If the file is not in cache, it goes directly to the origin from the edge server, and then gives it back to the user. If the file is already on the edge server, it immediately responds back. So it's just a whole big caching platform, actually. So the first test to test on the Champions League environment. So, well, we just started increasing load and looking at viewing the files. And after 15 minutes, it's already started giving lots of errors already. And then there are a few big spikes. And those spikes were HTTP 404 errors. And after some investigation, it turned out that the origin failed. The edge servers were putting too much load on the origin. And that was because the player was requesting a URL every 10 seconds to get a new playlist file, but it added a unique timestamp, for it to prevent caching. So the edge server get the URL and say, hey, okay, I don't have this file, so I go back to the edge server. And with 50,000 concurrent users and serving that file every 10 seconds, that meant 5,000 requests per second to the origin. So the origin was not capable of handling that. And I've seen that in much more tests, that when we test, when we also include CDN statics to the test, potentially we fail the origin too. Also, many edge nodes can stress your application. If you have many, for example, Akamai has lots of edge servers. We've seen that if you have a streaming application where there are many different bit rates and also many edge servers, it factors out that you can have an incredible amount of uncached requests. So your origin gets too much traffic anyway. So if you don't test that, you will not see that your origin will fail, or you will just fail in production when you have the live stream. We have seen that for a Formula One stream. First day, boom, it went wrong because they didn't test it. And once we tested it, we saw that the big amount of edge servers were requesting too many files on the origin, and the origin was not able to handle the traffic. There was also one case that if the users are not geographically spread well enough, it's easier to stress an edge server. We've seen that in tests too, that we stress edge servers. There was one case of a customer that had a CDN in front, mainly as an anti-DDoS platform. There was one customer which does so many requests per second to that application because it uses a web service. That customer of the customer was stressing edge servers constantly because the edge servers were not able to handle the requests per second. So it could also be, it's an edge case, but also if you handle a big amount of requests and serve lots of statics. There could potentially be quota limits and other limits on the CDN. So lots of tests that we've done, we found that, okay, after hundreds of thousands requests on that day, we hit quotas. We hit quota limits. So it's fine. It's easy to tune, of course, because if you have an application and you're just slowly increasing it, you set it up once and it's done. But for a TV show, there's not a second chance. So with testing, we figured out those all the quotas. And we also even had one case where an application was abusing the CDN to kind of get live feed from the application. I guess it didn't heard of WebSocket or something. But there was an application or a TV show where they expected 500,000 mobile users. And the application was written in a way that it pulls a JSON file every 2 seconds. So eventually, the environment got 250,000 requests per second. And even CloudFront had some kind of hidden setting that they were only able to serve 1 million requests per minute per zone. And so, yeah, we found that, but there was just no way they would be able to tune that. And specifically for that live show, the Amazon was sending that for that time. So as a final result, the Champions League stream went up to 50,000 users, and in the end, no problems. In the beginning, we had problem. I couldn't find any better picture of this test, unfortunately, because there was one stream that was not functioning, running well. So at that moment, some SysOp was just fixing that stream. But anyway, we were able to see 50,000 concurrent views, streamers, and so we were ready for. Ready for the event. And yeah, basically what I want to say is that if you have a large-scaled application in the cloud, you use cloud, you use autoscaling, it's very likely that you will have performance defects. So that's it.
Thank you, Jurek. Any questions?
I have a question. You showed response times every time in all the metric slides. What exactly does the response time mean in this case? Is it average?
Which response one do you mean?
All of them, really. I mean, all the response time slides had this, on which the response time was displayed, they had simply in seconds or perhaps fractions of seconds.
Yeah, well, I don't know if I really get the question right, but what.
Okay, is it an average response time at that time?
Yeah, if, for example, in this test, you see the brown line underneath, that's the average response time for that specific granularity.
Follow-up question, what kind of average is it? Is it the 50th quantile or 50th percentile, or is it?
Depends on the graph. In this graph, it's the average of per second of every individual request.
Okay, so it's a mean. Okay, I'm specifically asking this question because I have found out in the past that having simply the average of a response time carries, well,
no,
not enough information. You really should have.
I know where you're going.
Yeah, okay, fine then.
I agree that an average doesn't say anything if you don't know what the deviation is of response time. This is just a quick overview of the test. But when we are analyzing the tests, we look at response times of every individual page, request, etc., and try to try to analyze it as good as possible, because just an average is not saying anything at all.
Yeah, exactly.
You have to visualize it and see if do you have any spikes. Does my average mean anything?
Yeah, okay, thank you. That answered my question.
Yeah.
Any more questions? Yeah, over there. Hi.
it's nice to see that you can do your tests like slightly increasing, but can you also start test like 50,000 users at the same time? Like Champions League stream is a nice example.
Yeah.
It's not like people come in like in between the first and the 15th minute because everybody starts looking at the first second.
Yeah. Yeah, that's of course what we test with. We test with, this is just a ramp up in 12 minutes, which we thought was reasonable because that's what they've seen in the past, that in a 10 minute window, users come in. But this is just not a single test. We did lots of tests with different ramp up speeds and also with the 2 million tests, different ramp up speeds because, yeah, once the commercials are over, boom, everyone is hitting the application, opening the application, the app within a minute. So that's also important. The faster we ramp up, also the more requests per second it has to handle too. So that's really something always to consider in the performance test, the ramp up speed.
So, but you can test those patterns as well. Like everybody coming in the first minute is possible to test for you.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Well, could be the case for maybe 2 million tests would be a bit, because when you start a user, it also has some load on the load generator. So if you want to have a very, very quick ramp up, you have to make sure that you also have lots of hardware to be able to start users. Once the user started, it takes much less CPU than just the start of it. So the quicker you do the ramp up, the more capacity you need to have from a testing perspective. Yeah. But it's possible, no problem. You can sit the blue line. In this specific application, you can just draw it like you want how users start. So,
okay, thanks, Jurek.
Sure.